7 times during the past 20 years. This simple device with no moving parts has been launched on the Australian market, and each time it's become a giant fad. During the last yo-yo craze, more than 1 million of these were sold in the Sydney metropolitan area alone. Of course, the yo-yo is not an Australian invention. Prehistoric man used it as a hunting weapon. George IV played with one when it was called the bandolore, and members of the French aristocracy distracted themselves with yo-yos on their way to the guillotine. But Australians are particularly susceptible to fads and fashions like this one. We've eagerly embraced nearly all of them, and just occasionally, we've invented some of our own.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. It's still the same old story. A fight for love and glory. A case of do or die.
Back in the early 30s, mini golf was all the rage. And what better place for it than amongst the ruins of a temple overlooking Sydney's Middle Harbour? This mock Grecian edifice was in fact all that remained of a previous fad. In 1926, some smart operator had conned a group of Sydneysiders into believing that Christ's second coming was imminent, and that he would walk across the waters through the heads and up onto Balmoral Beach. His followers built this amphitheatre so they could have front stall seats to watch the Lord's arrival. 50 years later, there's a massive block of home units on the site. Hardly as attractive as the old temple, but perhaps a bit more practical. Ironically, there's been a revival of the mini golf craze, but now the carpeted greens are simply a place to dump Dad and the kids while Mum goes shopping. Children, of course, are the major supporters of any fad. And in the days before fiberglass skateboards, racing a billy cart down suburban streets was all a young boy ever wanted.
They're racing. What a race, what excitement, what a thrill, what joy for every boy. Anyhow, somehow, onward rode the 6 dozen. Gutters to the right of them, gutters to the left of them. And as they round the turn for home and into the street, I mean the straight, wild excitement prevails. The grade is steep, the speed increases. No speed cops about. And here's a real thrill, a real spill. Look out, look out. It's Willie Crash. Willie, I never expected to run into you. Fancy turning up at a place like this. Concrete Charlie is the winner. Well done, Concrete.
Another fad pioneered by the kids, only to be taken up by their parents, was the hula hoop. An Australian innovation, the hoop was taken by an American to California, where the Whammo company turned it into a craze which led to the sales of 50 million hoops.
It's the new shoop shoop hula hoop with a sound inside.
Oh, it's a shoop shoop hula hoop.
The hoop took America by storm, graduating from a children's toy to a teenage status symbol and finally to something of an art form. Despite its origins, the hula hoop was, like the yo-yo, really just another overseas craze imported for local consumption. And the same could be said of many of our other fads. There was faddism, too, in what we actually ate and drank. America may have had its drug stores and soda fountains, but the milk bar was an exclusively Australian invention. The first strawberry malted was thrown here in 1933. And by the late 40s, the nation's soda jerks and Jills were competing against each other in feats of long-distance decanting. How or why this particular form of liquid sculpture ever caught on is hard to say, but it's certainly a lot more entertaining than opening a pop-top can. But if the milk bar was Australia's great contribution to the panorama of international crazes, then this one, the pogo stick, certainly was not. America also gave us the short-lived craze of phone box stuffing, a sport which was strangely confined to university students.
And they've done it. 25. But Uncle Sam's lasting gift to the faddish side of Australian life was far more substantial than cramming teenagers into a phone box. And of course, it came from the world of show business.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Star Drive-In.
When I was a kid, the word drive-in was as modern as tomorrow. But now it's full of nostalgia. I remember we used to get here while the sun was still up to get a good spot, and we'd try to get the front wheels of the car perfectly on top of one of these mounds here. And there'd be the familiar crash on the glass as the speaker hooked onto the window, and of course the knob always seemed to fall off. And at half time we'd get out of the car and race across these mounds like Lawrence of Arabia to be first to get a hot dog. And of course, when you came back you always seemed to lose your car. But we'd find it and settle down for the main feature. If that got boring, maybe a bit of fun and games in the back seat, if not in your own car, in the one next to you. And at worst, it rained, and we'd sit there peering through the windscreen wipers at Charlton Heston building the pyramids. How did television compete with all that?
Will you please leave plates, knives and forks on the base of the speaker stand? Thank you for your attention. We hope you have a very enjoyable evening.
For most of its fashion history, Australia has survived on imported styles and ideas. This advertising short was made in 1911 to display the latest outfits available from the exclusive Melbourne store, George's. And it shows just how ludicrous British designs were in the Australian environment. Heavy coats, furs, and even muffs might have been just the thing for a European winter. But not even Melbourne's climate could have justified this wholesale slaughter of rabbits in the cause of high fashion. By the 20s, style-conscious ladies had aligned their taste to the prevailing mood of feminism. Fast young women were openly smoking cigarettes through a long-distance arrangement, and even made personal calls on the telephone without being formally introduced. The spirit of liberation was so strong that soon the ladies were even allowed to do their own commentaries for the newsreels.
A complete expression of independence was gained in the beach shots of recent seasons. Now, women have reverted, with their innate love of the beautiful, to long skirts. And Miss 1931 combines the classic lines of 100 years ago with modernistic license in this, the new divided skirt gown.
But, try as they might, the massed strength of Australian womanhood still didn't seem capable of developing a distinctly homegrown look.
Women had never worn things that were Australian. Not from the time they stepped ashore in 1788. So that ostrich feathers, whatever was worn overseas, was the correct thing to wear. Mm. Women in Australia wore fashions that women in England were wearing. The difference was they wore them 6 months later. It had nothing to do with Australian climate. It had nothing to do with the Australian mood, the Australian character.
And some of the things they wore in Europe were decidedly strange. This forbidding selection of ironclad corsets was offered to Madame by mail order, and it led to quite natural speculation amongst our menfolk as to what else their wives and girlfriends were wearing underneath. In 1932, the year they opened the Harbour Bridge, this was the height or maybe the depth of fashion underwear. It was all considered so daring the men were requested to look the other way. Of course, none of them did. Who'd want to miss this symphony in glove silks and cottons, or the fruity-voiced commentator who even dared to use the odd suggestive word?
Particularly the knicker effect garments, which are tending to replace the bloomer effect in conformity with the present day style of cropping.
Before long, we were in the age of synthetics. Rayon, nylon, Dacron, in fact, anything that ended in on. It was the beginning of the baby doll craze. While half the nation's young girls still looked like escapees from Swan Lake, the others were flouncing about in shorty pajamas, ready for an all-night pillow party. But Australian motherhood has always been built on a firm foundation. And when a girl married, it was time to move up to the heavy-duty stuff. Cantilevered bras that looked like they'd been cast in a foundry. Corsets so sturdy they stood as examples of structural engineering. Today they've all disappeared and women have returned to the unsupported look of the 20s. It makes you wonder why we ever bothered changing styles in the first place.
But every fashion is bad when you look at it. It's marvellous in retrospect and shocking in retrospect, because it's never just one look. There are always a combinations of looks, and they're always the bad taste bits that sort of get in amongst everything else, and people tend to remember those.
No matter how grotesque the trend, Australian women have remained dedicated followers of fashion, even if it meant draping a dead fox over each shoulder. With the war over, the British influence quickly diminished, and Australian women began to take many of their fashion ideas from Hollywood. For a while, everything had a shiny Rita Hayworth look, exotic satin creations that reeked of a steamy night in Marrakesh, but maybe a bit much for down at the club. Yet soon, all this strutting up and down catwalks would be gone, swept aside by the most potent fashion accessory of all, bare flesh. Interest would shift from what women were wearing to what they weren't. It was Melbourne Cup Week, 1965, and a battle between two beautiful women was about to change the course of Australian fashion forever. In the right corner, French model Christine Bourget. In the left, Jean Shrimpton from Great Britain.
Well, it was very funny. There were two rival organisations. There was Wool and Synthetics. And Wool brought out Jean Shrimpton, and Synthetics brought out a gorgeous Parisian doll called Christine Bourget. Well, she arrived earlier than the shrimp, and when she stepped off the airplane, she fainted right away. And it just happened the wool board fellow there, Tony Lewis, ran forward and grabbed her, and he dropped into her arms. And absolutely marvellous, made every front page in the country, you see. Well, come Saturday, which was Derby Day, I was talking to Christine Bourget, and she said, "I understand that the shrimp's going to be late." I said, "That's right." And she probably won't even get there in time for the Derby. And I said, "Well, it's a bit doubtful." And she started to giggle, you see. And I said, "What are you laughing at?" And she said, "I just can't think of anything the shrimp can do to upstage me at this time." And of course, he turned up in the skirt, which was 4 inches above the knee, and she not only got every front page in the country, she got reporters flying out from London to get the story.
The brazen hussy was practically naked. Not only did she show almost a quarter of a thigh, but she had no hat, no gloves, and horror of horrors, no stockings. To make matters worse, the cheeky little minx was wearing a man's watch. Where, they asked, was it all going to end? It's hard to imagine now the uproar which surrounded Jean Shrimpton's hemline here in 1965. But you have to remember that this was the first deliberately exposed human knee ever seen inside the members' enclosure at Flemington.
Melbourne Cup Week had always been something of a yardstick for Australian fashion, long before 1965, when Jean Shrimpton brought the miniskirt here to stay. During the 1890s, it was all crinolines, flowery hats and parasols. By 1915, the men were actually more interesting to look at, still clinging to their cutaway coats and shiny top hats, despite the November heat. Ten years later, the flappers were in command, gay, extravagant and determined to catch every last thrill of the jazz age. We'd calmed down a bit by the 30s, and designs had taken on a more reserved, responsible tone. Australian women were learning to appreciate the subtleties of cut and line. But it would be 40 years, and only when a truly grand occasion demanded it, before our First Lady produced a dress that caused an international sensation.
I never thought twice about it. Never. I actually was going to wear that to crown Miss Australia that year. But then President Nixon asked us to go over to the United States rather hurriedly, and I had to cancel the engagement because I'd be away. And so I took my white dress with me. And naturally, if you have a new dress, you think of wearing it to the White House, and that's exactly how it happened.
The photographers and the press had a field day. That one decidedly daring evening gown kept any serious discussion of the Prime Minister's tour off the front pages for days. President Nixon's problems with unsuccessful cover-ups were still to come. But for Sonia McMahon, it was a venture into foreign affairs she'll never forget.
But you know, it's not all that daring unless you get caught by photographers walking up and down stairs sideways.
But in many ways, the early 70s were the end of the catwalk for high fashion. The harsh modernism of Dior's sack look made a mockery of the word style, and we were at last beginning to cast a critical eye over the strange creations that kept arriving from overseas. In 1971, the big department stores made a concerted attempt to preserve the prestige of haute couture. But even collections from the great designers like Pucci of Italy had little real impact on the way Australian women chose to dress. Gradually, perhaps the final frontier of our cultural cringe was beginning to disappear.
Up to 5 years ago, they used to say, look, you know, I'm not spending money because I am going overseas and I will buy my wardrobe in Paris or London or Italy or New York. Today, the same people come to me and they tell me where they're going and I outfit them for the trip. So I feel that we are more than up to date with the European fashion, and in fact we are creating some of our own back here.
Today, showings like this Zampatti summer range help support the 120,000 people who work in the local fashion industries. And the styles make a striking contrast to the prim designs of half a century ago. There seems to have been a final coming to terms with the climate, even if we do still tend to adapt the best ideas from Europe for our own needs. True, most of us spend a fair deal of our time in t-shirts and jeans, but as long as there are women who will want to be complimented on their appearance, then there'll always be a future for Australian fashion.
In 1900, the Reverend Dr. Torrey of Melbourne warned that if a girl knew what a man was thinking as he was dancing with her, she'd never dance again. But that's exactly why she did dance again, and again, and again. And that's exactly why the Wowsers preached against the demon dance for most of this century, from the tango to the twist, from the samba to the stomp.
In 1914, the New South Wales Presbyterian Assembly denounced Sydney women for their shameful dresses and naughty new dances. The magazine Melbourne Punch recalled philosophically that bustles and crinolines had been just as hotly condemned. But now there was no stopping the wave of sinful modern dancing. Suddenly, skirts were higher than ever before. It was the era of the flapper, cloche hats, silk stockings, fake jewellery, bobbed hair, and of course, the Charleston.
This reflected the people's anxieties and freedom from anxieties after being in a war such as the First World War, and again after the Second World War when the jitterbug crew was created.
It's the jiviest jitter jamboree since Juno's joust with Jupiter, or did she? Anyway, it's so well.
As the commentator Charles Lawrence showed only too well, the jitterbug defied description. This was the maddest of all. It was such a craze that it soon produced teams of professionals who attracted huge crowds at places like the Bondi Pavilion. Artie Smith and Aileen Joyce were pros who specialised in the jitterbug, Lindy Hop and the boogie woogie.
Well, I had a unique continuous set of phrase that was nobody could catch me on. My feet work was pretty fast, and also my partner, she was double jointed.
Oh, it was fabulous. It was very strenuous. Entailed a lot of training. We used to train 3 days a week to get in trim. It's like a racehorse, I suppose.
Well, there was one where I used to put her right up on my shoulders, and then I'd throw her to the ground, and she'd go in a complete split.
Of course, being dropped 6 feet onto the floor in the splits didn't suit the average Australian matron. In the next 2 decades, we looked for something modern we could all do, and soon we found it. A dance so simple it's hard to see why its creator had to come halfway round the world to show us how to do it. Chubby Checker demonstrated at Sydney Airport. You could do the twist even if you were poured into a pantsuit. Almost every overseas craze can bank on getting a reasonable run in this country. And the Hokey Pokey and the Hootenanny were no exceptions. And it does lead to the question, did we ever invent anything of our own? It seems that only one dance craze actually originated in Australia, the stomp.
Come on, Johnny. Let's get going.
The stomp required its own special uniform, rubber sneakers and extra OS skivvies or jumpers. For once, the clergy was quiet. It had absolutely no sex appeal whatsoever. Where it came from, no one's quite sure. But some people came to be identified with it more than any others.
Anybody could do it. It was less complicated than rock and roll, and even less complicated than the twist. I mean, overweight people couldn't twist very well, but anybody could do the stomp, and it stayed for a little while, and it is Australian.
The stomp disappeared, but dancing, like sex, appears to be here to stay. These days, when couples glide gracefully around the floor at the local town hall, it's hardly a picture of debauchery. But it's sobering to remember that only 40 years ago, a certain Reverend Wallace of Fitzroy denounced the dance hall as the nursery of divorce, the training ship of prostitution, and a modern ulcer threatening public morality.
A sigh is just a sigh.